This is one of the headsets we are using to reproduce the mixed reality version of the advanced command post. It costs something like 400 euros.
This is Gustavo Medina, the CEO of XRF AI. He founded the startup in late 2022 with one mission: to help improve decision-making during crises. In September 2024, the company raised 2.3 million euros in seed funding, riding the wave of investor interest in Europe's growing defense tech sector. According to the NATO Innovation Fund, venture capital investment in deep tech defense, security, and resilient startups has grown from $159 million in 2014 to $5.2 billion in 2024, a 32-fold increase in just a decade. VC firms invest in early-stage companies in exchange for a stake in their future growth. And when their money floods a sector, it can signal an industry on the cusp of rapid expansion.
We've seen a massive frenzy and demand for defence investments, and that's in both public and private markets. And one example of this is Spotify CEO Daniel Ek's venture capital firm, which held a 600 million euro funding round for the defence tech firm Helsing earlier this year.
You might know Helsing for its drones, which are used for underwater surveillance and military strikes. But defense tech goes far beyond drones. Across Europe, startups are building unmanned vehicles for land, sea, and air, developing quantum-based warfare sensors, and creating AI-powered systems for cyber surveillance.
There has been a fundamental shift in defense economics across Europe. It's not just an increase in defense spending, it's what is defense.
So why are investors betting on European defense tech? And what more needs to be done for the sector to truly compete at a global level?
We have seen a huge ramp up in investment in defence in Europe over the last 3 years now. And it's really driven by the threat posed by Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine in February 2022. But also it's the perception now that Europe needs to fund more of its own security.
In March 2025, the European Union announced its Rearm Europe plan, which mobilises up to 800 billion euros in defence spending. And a few months later, NATO leaders, most of them European, committed to ramping up their defense budgets to 5% of their country's GDP after months of pressure from the US.
It's the question over the commitment or reliability of the US as an ally in the region. And that obviously varies almost daily.
Europe has a lot of work to do to rearm. Over recent decades, its capabilities have slipped, while the US, China, and Russia have surged ahead on equipment, personnel, and expenditure. And with new tech offering fresh ways to boost military capabilities, the industry is shifting focus from hardware to software, especially deep tech. Think cutting-edge advances in science and engineering, like quantum computing, AI, biotech, and space innovation. Between 2022 and 2024, European startups made up the largest share of VC funding in a few key deep tech areas: quantum cryptography, grid technology, and quantum computers and processors. These pieces of tech enable faster and more secure communication channels, both on the battlefield and to counter grey zone threats. Think economic coercion, cyber attacks, proxy warfare, and even undermining or overthrowing governments. In Europe, grey zone activities led by Russia quadrupled between 2022 and 2023, and then nearly tripled between 2023 and 2024.
We're currently looking in two segments of defense tech, the one we've always looked at, which is cyber, and then on physical defense. We spend time on dual use and defensive defense. We have historically been early stage investors across all technology: enterprise, fintech, cyber, and consumer. We invest in long cycles. So one of the trends that I'm really interested in is the software defined defense. So that's bringing in the software element to overlay the hardware.
Technology is at the center of no less than 9 defense initiatives launched by the European Commission since 2017. There's the research branch of the European Defense Fund, for example, which prioritizes autonomous systems, AI, and advanced modular microchips known as chiplets. Or the EU Defense Innovation Scheme as part of the EDF, which encourages applications for advanced sensors, human-machine cooperation, and biotechnologies. These funding channels come in addition to member states' own investments, like Germany's 500 billion euro infrastructure fund and the 1 billion euro NATO Innovation Fund, the world's first multi-sovereign venture capital fund.
Historically, infrastructure-based defense had been a mismatch with the venture capital like fund and funding cycles because you had this really wide gap between innovation and actually like procurement and use. The easiest example of this is, you know, fighter jet gets sold on year T0. It gets into production on T plus 20. Our fund lives are on average 10 years. That's outside of like a VC investable asset.
We were profitable from the very first day, but at some point we thought that we wanted to buy time. We went really, really fast. And now we are thinking about starting a new process because we want to go even faster and start working on these autonomous vehicles.
The speed of innovation has picked up on the defense physical side, and that has been matched with also a speed of procurement on the government side. And so now suddenly businesses that historically were out of scope for us have come into scope by marrying cutting edge tech, dual use, and a client that's actually predictable in a reasonable time.
Another reason venture capitalists have traditionally shied away from defense investments is because their backers, known as limited partners or LPs, often have strict rules about where the money can go.
Part of that is because in the private space, private equity funds sometimes have restrictions on where they can invest in terms of companies, geographies, and sectors. And more broadly, there has been ethical concerns around how the products that these companies make are used. If they're going to be used in warfare or military campaigns, that has put off a lot of investors in the past.
What we're seeing is a few entities start to revise those exclusionary policies to try and build in the potential for greater investment in defence.
Startups seeking investment, particularly from the European Investment Fund's Defence Equity Facility, need to demonstrate a dual-use purpose, products that can be applied in both military and civilian settings.
We have two hats in terms of different markets, and for VCs, it's easier. Being a dual-use company, I guess at some point, every contract, every funding, every resources we got from government, for them now in Spain, at least it's easy to justify like, okay, we are investing on these guys, we are giving them this contract, but what they are doing, we can also use it for wildfires. Same thing happened with VCs.
The NATO Innovation Fund also requires tech to have a dual use to access its funding. And if they meet its criteria, startups are connected to businesses and defense departments across NATO's 32 member countries.
NATO has a different approach in terms of startups. They have an exercise in Poland every year called C-Weeks. It's an interoperability exercise. So we make an exercise with Italian army. They were using the same protocol. So we got there. We deploy our system and make the test and it works. But real operation in Europe so far, it's always training, actually, it's exercise. Probably at the end of this year, the Spanish army will use our technology in a real scenario.
Despite the recent momentum, Europe still has work to do to get up to speed, especially when compared to the US. Between 2021 and the third quarter of 2024, US defense tech startups received nearly $5 billion in investment. That's 2.4 times the volume invested in European defense tech startups. But where does that money come from? In Europe, local investors are active in early and breakout stage rounds. Yet, it's North American investors who are leading the charge in later stage deals exceeding $200 million. And these large-scale investments are fueling expansion, paving the way for IPOs and delivering stronger returns.
Here in Europe, it's new for everyone. In Europe, we have this mindset of national champion. And that's going to be very, very hard to small companies in Europe to grow up fast enough. In the United States, for example, the government gave $22 billion to Android to build mixed reality military helmet. So that's not happening in Europe, not definitely in Spain. So now we need to try to convince them that the innovation is coming from us.
There is the risk that the marketplace is getting potentially overheated because there's the increased interest, increased investment. It can be quite a difficult marketplace to map. I don't think it's therefore that surprising that you had oversubscribed funding rounds for companies like Helsing. And it's because they're established. In terms of the recapitalization efforts, if the funding levels increase sort of too fast, then domestic industry might not be able to respond and you're looking at purchases from other exporters.
Meanwhile, Russia is ramping up production of long-range drones, reportedly manufacturing thousands a month. As this capability grows, Europe's challenge will be scaling up its own domestic production of defense tech to keep pace.
A lot of market watchers are saying that this will probably take years to actually trickle down into companies' bottom lines. And the companies themselves have said that they can't really start to ramp up production until they get the orders. So we're still waiting for the budgets to really kick in. Things like the squeeze on rare earth minerals that we've seen this year. That's sort of contingent on Europe's relationship with China, because China is such a massive supplier of these minerals, but they are critical to the production of defense technologies. So things like advanced radar systems, propulsion technologies, laser guidance, all of that relies on rare earths.
My biggest challenge right now is to be able to accomplish that roadmap faster. It's very hard to get specific skills of developers or people in this industry because it's something that never existed before. And this drone industry, it's okay for the civil use and the dual use, but for the military is a completely different thing. You know, you don't have GPS.
A lot of countries in Europe made their defense budget plans. They make them in the autumn of the previous year. So a lot of those have been revised. And so we are likely to see more and more revisions to spending. In a way, it's good. It shows responsiveness to the emerging threat, but it also does create volatility, lack of certainty, and it does risk inefficient spending, which is just becoming increasingly unforgivable because there are so many pressures on public finances.
We are seeing public markets being shaken a bit by the potential for a ceasefire or peace in Ukraine. But at the same time, analysts have told us that they are expecting the investment momentum to continue. There is really an appetite that's not going anywhere.